making a second quick return visit. But award yourself a pair of yellow Wellington boots, if from this record, within 10 seconds or so, you can tell me who will be joining us to rap for the next hour. There I was in my hotel room, and this strange person came along and said, hey, you got to do a radio show. Go away, man, I want to go home. Come on, wake up.
Wake up, everybody, no more sleeping in bed. No more back thinking, time for thinking ahead. World has changed so very much from what it used to be. There's so much hatred.
Who do you reckon it is, Cosmos?
Yeah, it's Teddy Pendergrass.
You're absolutely right. Well done. Award yourself some yellow Wellington boots. Pendergrass back in London town in a big way and has dropped in to rap with us for the next hour or so. Does that still make you feel good to hear that? I saw a little smile come just to the side of your mouth.
I haven't heard it since it was released. I haven't heard it since 1975.
And it still sounds good, doesn't it? And it rather fits.
Significant. The lyric is still significant.
Very much so. A lot of the Gamble Huff songs, though, if you get out the Gamble Huff songbook and go back many years, a lot of them are absolutely fit, don't they? 1982, everything that's going on in the States and worldwide.
They might have been just a little ahead of their time, because it might have been just the beginning of what's happening, what's really starting to happen now, economically and just
the whole thing.
Wars and fights and just everything. I think it was just a little ahead of the time. They had a lot of insight. They still do.
Mm. But tell me, what happens to a night person that gets dragged out in the middle of the day? What do? Do you have two watches? Do you have a Teddy watch and a London watch and a New York watch and a Los Angeles watch? Is it real bad news getting up in the middle of the day? Because you are a night person, aren't you?
Not actually. See, that's the problem. I'd rather be a day person, and when I'm not working, I am a day person. I'm up at 8 o'clock in the morning, and I'm going about daily things, and my system turns around to go to work. So when it doesn't compensate the rest, it's bad news for me. I'm not in the best of moods. You know, I'm fine, but, you know, it's kind of like a little bit on the line, you know. And then what bothers me is because I'm wondering if I'll be fit vocally for night's work to come. And that's my most important problem. That's what bothers me most of all. Because if I'm in no shape to do my job at night, that it wasn't worth getting up in the morning for.
How's your throat feeling at the moment? Is it beginning?
You can hear it.
Yeah. Is it beginning to open, or will it close and open, close and open, or does it, as the night time comes along, does your brain say to your throat, hey,
it's time to go to work?
It's time to go to work. And the throat says, oh, okay, okay, all right, all right.
I said, I hope you aren't.
Pendergrass the whole time was laughing at me, and Teddy was saying, I hope it's not. And I have proved that BBC coffee does amazing things to people with croaky voices. That woke you up, didn't it? Have you ever tasted coffee like that?
No, I haven't.
It's a return. You wish you were still a drummer sometimes when you have to worry about the throat. And starting off with drumming, do you ever do any drumming now?
Yeah, you very do. Much so. Yeah.
Well, you can't play with yourself, can you? If,
well, you can.
He is awake.
Oh, God. You're good at waking people up, aren't you?
Good. You're with it. You're with us. Did you play with other bands, or what did you do? Put down your own backing tracks and what sort of things?
I have backed my own tracks. As a matter of fact, I have a band that I play with when I'm off. When I'm in, I'm on vacation, and when I'm at home, there's a group of fellas. We get together and go to one another's house and just have a good time.
All right. Is it bad news being Teddy Pendergrass's drummer then? Because you are known for a great voice, but if I'm the drummer in Teddy Pendergrass's backing band, I've got to get it absolutely right, or do you not look back and check?
My drummer catches hell more than any other drummer in the entire world. I'm constantly looking at him. I'm constantly sending messages, you know, that I contact, and he has to read it. But he's been doing it successfully for 6 years.
And he's got used to you, has he?
Yeah. He had to. Had no other choice.
It's the boss. He's checking me out. It's time for love with my guest, Teddy Pendergrass. There you are. BBC Coffee in 30 seconds. He brought the man down. He's in London. It's time for love. Tony from Farnham sends all his love to Emma Hamilton of Finchley. What a lovely way to do it. Now, who are those good backing vocalists there? You sound like you've got a couple of tricky ones sneaked in there.
Kenny Gamble, Leanne Huff, and myself.
Do they do a lot of backing vocals on with Philadelphia artists?
Yes. We're the kind of record company, we don't have certain people to do certain things who's ever around. And just so happens even the secretaries can sing, but whoever, we just go out in the hallway. Come here, you, we need you over here. Whoever's in the studio, they've done it to me or other people. Come here, tell you, we need your voice real quick. Okay, be right there. That's just the way we do it. And Gamble and Huff were walking down the hallway and I needed them. So I said, come on in, guys.
Do most of the staff there have, they don't have to be able to type very well, but they must be able to sing a bit in case they need it in the studio.
That's right.
Yeah, that works.
They're not busy typing too much anyway.
We don't mind you can't type as long as you can sing. You've got the job, because we might just need... Why have you come back to London so quickly? It's not that we don't want you here, but to come back at two quick bashes, because I was looking...
Double dose.
Yeah, a double dose of Teddy Pendergrass, because I was looking at your... gold discs in the States enough to weigh you down, and you certainly couldn't walk in the mud with them in your pocket. Is it more fun coming to a place where you're not yet collecting gold discs? Is it more of a challenge for you? Is it stimulating? Or?
It's very stimulating, and it's new. It's new meat. It's new red meat, and it proves to be somewhat of a challenge, and I happen to like challenges.
Mm.
I thrive off of them.
Do you know who told I was talking to, it was about 9 months ago, and I said to Marvin Gaye, who's your favourite singer? He said, Teddy Pendergrass, he's great. Do you have favourite singers and artists that you like to listen to?
I like to listen to all. I think they all sound incredibly well.
But do you go as your a ballad singer, do you go for ballad singing artists, or do you have taste in rock or taste in gospel or music?
I appreciate it's hard for me. I never collected records as a kid. I never had a favorite artist. Only favorites I had were gospel, because that's all we played in my house. So I never really got into that thing of having a favorite. And every record that I had as a kid, I still have, and haven't bought any new ones. And it sounds I don't have any of my own. I just don't collect records. And so that's why when I listen to each artist, I pick up something that they do very well, and I appreciate that.
And it could be anybody in any range of music.
Yeah.
Absolutely. What about the radio stations at home, though? Do you listen to a country station, top 40 station?
I don't listen to the radio.
Or you don't listen to any music at all. Is it a deliberate policy not to listen to music? Is it to maintain your own style and your own sound so you're fresh when you go in to do something and you're not influenced by anything else?
That's part of the reason. And then it's also a conscious effort because I am at home. And when you hear music in your ears, you've been on tour for 6 months, you know, and the side fills and the monitors, and you kind of build yourself up for it. And when you get home, you really just want to kind of sink back.
What do you do? Bury your head into business, because you run a lot of your own business affairs, don't you? And you seem to enjoy doing that. What we got? Teddy bear jeans, was it? I read somewhere.
Yeah, there's an entire clothing line coming out. And a lot of other things that we're doing.
Which is entirely separate from singing. It's strictly business, and you enjoy doing that.
Yeah.
Because there aren't many artists, are there, who actually like the business side. They get very fed up with it, you know, and they say, oh, well, we'll leave it to somebody else. We'll just go and sing and play.
Yeah, and I don't know where they are today.
There ain't no flies on this teddy bear. Teddy Pendergrass, the Robbie Vincent Saturday Show. Is a song worth singing, Teddy Pendergrass, because you actually came over here with Harold Melvin and the Blue Notes, didn't you?
Yes, I did.
And did some dates. That was a whole different ball game. That was very much, I remember seeing you at Fairfield Halls in Croydon with Harold Melvin.
Really?
Yeah, and Hot Chocolate, in fact,
Hot
with the
Chocolate.
Other band,
sure.
Which I know you all appreciated. But really, Harold Melvin were out of place in that gig, weren't they? That it really needed to be a sit-down luncheon type cabaret, opposed to a concert. Did you feel that?
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed.
And a little bit uncomfortable?
Well, I was just a little bit, I felt smothered. It's this wild animal. It's got to go. And it was that way for 7 years. I mean, I appreciated it. I enjoyed being there. But it's just I had a lot more energy, seemingly, than everybody else around me. And that was the level that we had been doing things. That's the level he had been doing things for 10, 15 years. And that's as far as it ever went.
Did initially you joined Harold Melvin and the Blue Notes after they split up, didn't they? And they reshaped the band, and that's when you went into them. That's how the whole story started, wasn't
it? Yeah, as a drummer.
Right, as a drummer. But was that your first band, or who else had you been playing with before that?
Oh, no, I have been traveling. I've been traveling professionally since I'm about 16. And my first trip was to Canada. First trip away from home was to Canada. Real lonely. But it was with a guy who, if you couldn't afford James Brown, you hired this gentleman. And he looked like James Brown. He sang every James Brown song. He talked like James Brown. He walked like he just was a protege of James Brown. And so I had a thorough dose of James Brown records. And that's the first time I went away to play. It was with his, and his name was Little Royal.
Do you ever see any of the people that you used to play with and you served your apprenticeship with?
No, I don't know why. You know, I'd like to. I'd really like to. As a matter of fact, I'd like to sit down and play again. But I don't know if they're still playing. I haven't seen anybody.
You would have thought over all these years, well, at least send you a Christmas card or something. I'll say to them,
well, actually, I'll tell you, the bass player that was with me when I was the drummer for the Blue Notes has started playing for them again, so I have seen him. He's a little guy they call Rags. He's about 4 foot three, a little short guy, but plays a big bass guitar. And it was quite interesting to see him.
The James Brown impersonator, was he almost as good as James Brown?
Actually, he studied James Brown so much so. I mean, there's nothing like the original, of course.
No.
But you really actually thought if you couldn't afford the $10 to go see James and you can only afford two, it didn't bother you any. Because he was that good. He was real good. I have to admit, the guy was good.
You have no idea where he is now?
No, when I left him, we were in Canada. We had been back in Canada, Quebec City, and I was fed up there. So I had $25 in my pocket and out of my country. And instead of riding free back to Connecticut, which is close to Philadelphia, I just quit in Canada.
And that was it. That was it. And strangely enough, with Harold Melvin the Blue Notes at the Fairfield Halls in Croydon with Hot Chocolate some years ago, and that's where you are, I think, tomorrow night, isn't it, as well?
Is it the same hall?
Yeah, it is.
I told you I passed this way before.
Yeah, right. And that little thing you wrote on the dressing room wall, still there, they could never scrub it off.
Did you check the bathroom?
Yes. You have been there.